Yeah, I think there's a little wind in there, but maybe later on if you feel like talking about it again, we'll talk about it.
I was going to tell you a little bit more about the grandfather anyway.
Okay.
You know, he was, told you he was politically minded.
Oh, yeah, this is Steven.
Yeah.
Steven, okay.
And he bragged about being a populist. And in a lot of his letters, he talks about being a populist. And he's telling about, Uncle Tobe, that wasn't his name, that's his nickname. His name was James Bolney, B-O-L-N-E-Y. Then Uncle Polk came along, he was an next brother, and his name was Truston Polk, named for the governor of Missouri. Mm-hmm. And Uncle Mark came along, and his name was Mark Pomeroy. Mark Pomeroy was somebody who, President Maker, I forget how, President Grant, I guess, he pushed it from. He was somebody kind of like the Rockefeller.
Yeah.
I can't tell you any more about him right now, but anyway, they were wound up on these national important names to name their children. But this Truston Polk, who was a governor, I've got that, and I can show that to you. I think I've got it out. A letter from Truston Polk to my grandfather, telling why he couldn't support Horace Greeley for president.
So he was an avowed populist then. I mean, he wasn't just a populist in a general sense. He was for the Populist Party.
Yeah, he was a Populist Party, but technically a Democrat.
Yeah.
And a Southern sympathizer.
Yeah.
But a hideout from the service. It's like a lot of people, he just didn't know who his friends were. You know, you live on one farm, and here's the next farm would be a Southern sympathizer, and the next one would be another. You didn't dare open your mouth, so you just stayed out of things. And that's one of the things that's happening.
And this is the farm he's on, is the same one that you're talking about that's out on James River.
Yeah. But that originally, when the 1841 was a Hagan farm.
I know that.
All right, and then Grandpa Galbraith, Stephen, came from Tennessee with his father, Andrew, and he married one of the Hagan girls. Thereby, that's how the farm got into the Galbraith family.
Uh-huh.
That's how I have to have some of it again. I don't want to wait.
Sometimes gets so directional, I don't think that's the guitar.
Yeah, G or D in the wrong spot a couple of times. Isn't going to be. Where was that other part we thought we could walk?
We've been wondering for a long time. That recording was swapped because I missed the thing I was trying to send away. Usually I just go right back to G and we were playing with Lonnie's son and he. Yeah, go ahead. Let's get started. The main minor. We used to go straight back down and that works in just nice.
That's all. I wanted to clear that in there.
Jared always impressed me as an awfully good guitar player.
He is.
He's not a guitar player.
Now, I think he kind of... Lonnie doesn't like a lot of that stuff. Jared
will just
and throw a bunch of stuff in, you know, like that.
Lonnie gets mad when people do.
Lonnie doesn't like to put some minors that we...
He wants that straight stuff. Yeah. I've been around with you about that.
Thank you. Arthur Smith tune.
I don't think he wrote it.
No, but he recorded
it. Yeah, he's the one that made it. I think everybody traces his version, other version to that one. And everybody picked it up off of him.
That and that Smith rag, too. I guess that made the one that he came out.
Thank you.
running down some old figure over here on north side of Springfield named Andy Foster. He's kind of a honky tonk figure. He likes meeting bars. And he played, that's a little different from the way all these fellas around here play in Carroll County. He called it Rabbit Foot Blues.
Is he still around?
No, he's dead.
How long ago did you learn from him?
Oh, about 8 or 9 years ago.
One of the questions I wanted to ask you, we didn't have time to talk about it.
All right.
I wanted to ask you if there were, in addition to your family and your Uncle Tobe, were there other fiddlers that you would single out as being ones that you really learned a lot from or that you liked their music a lot?
Clay, Uncle Tobe's son.
Clay. Is he still living?
No. Well, they're all dead now.
Okay.
And he had Clay and Fred and Logan. He had three boys.
Uh-huh.
And they played together, and a lot. Logan didn't play the fiddle. He played the cello a little bit. He played the mandolin a little bit. But he played mostly guitar. And Fred and Clay were fiddlers.
Did they stay around this area?
Yeah.
Move out?
They all were right around here. Played for lots and lots of dances. All up into the early 40s.
Did they have a special band that they played? Did they have a name for the band or anything?
No, I didn't have a name for it, but they at this house of Uncle Tobe, they had a lot of musicales or music parties or dances there.
Yeah.
It's a big old house. It's right out here in northeast corner of Springfield. It had a living room, 36 to 40 feet long. And they could dance three square dance sets in it.
Uh-huh.
And had a piano in the corner. Now, those three boys and a daughter named Ora. And they all played. Ora played the piano. And Fred and Clay interchanged on the fiddle and guitar. And Logan played the guitar and the cello a little bit. And then Uncle Tobe would come in on there and he'd play for a square dance. So I think I've told you about, I was there one time when we had a kind of a family reunion and there were, everybody dancing and everybody playing was named Galbraith.
How many people were there all those?
Well, I know there was one full set of all Galbraiths and all the Galbraiths were playing.
In other words, there were, what do you say, a full set and eight people
eight
dancing?
Eight people and say five playing.
Uh-huh.
There were 13 and besides a lot of others around there who didn't play or were listening.
Well, have you listened to any other fiddlers that you were developing much beyond them? Are there any other old fiddlers outside the family that you listened to?
Well, that's a gathering place for a lot of fiddlers. There was an old family down here named, what's the old man named? Toasty for you?
Hello?
No. Your cousin lives on, Norman's cousin lives on the place.
Oh, Weatherman.
Weatherman,
yeah.
Weatherman was an old family here.
Christian County.
Yeah, Christian County.
Well, in teens, I think they're
yeah, they in Teen County.
Yeah, really.
But they were the Weathermans, old Uncle
Sam was the patriarch of the whole
yeah.
thing. Yeah, he was.
And they were from Teeny County, when you
think. Well, they lived in Teeny and Christian, both, yeah. Because they butt each other.
There was a feud down there. That's one of the old stories. The Ballou family and the Weathermans weren't interested, but the Ballou family and the Meadows,
yeah.
They were kin to each other, but they had a feud that lasted there, and a number of people were killed there.
Yeah.
But the Weatherman, the one to Sam Weatherman, he'd had his finger caught in something, and his hand would just look kind of like that. And he could play in flat keys pretty well. He played E flat and B flat, which fiddlers don't do much nowadays. And he's a pretty good fiddler. He had two boys. One of them went blind. I forget what happened to him. His name was Keats, K-W-E-T-S.
Mm-hmm.
And Hobe Weatherman was the other. Hobe played anything he picked up, anything with strings on it. Good banjo player, tenor banjo player. Good guitar player, good fiddler, and just about anything. Now they congregated out there, especially the younger ones. Hope was. And then there's a fellow you've probably heard of named Lenny Aylshire.
Yeah.
He had all of his fingers off of that.
Yeah.
He played the fiddle with that one finger.
Did I was going to ask you, I had for some time he wanted to call him up, but I heard he died recently.
No, I talked to him, when were we in Mountain View? April, first April. When I came back, I called him because Grandpa Jones used to have
Well, that's what I'm wanting to talk. See, I'm working with Grandpa on his autobiography now. I'm going to do the writing and editing for him, and he talks about Lenny a lot. In fact, that issue of the Devil's Box has a picture of Lenny. And I thought if he felt up to talking, I'd just about to spend a couple of hours talking to him.
Well, he lived up 2440 North Prospect here in town.
You think he must?
I think it's 2440. And he's a fine old boy, right at 90 now. And he may be 90, and he's somebody else that had a light stroke. I don't think he'd do much music at all.
What's his address again?
Wait just a minute. I think it's 2440. I called him, and we got back from down there because I talked to Grandpa John. He said, I said, you an old friend of Lenny Aylshire's? And he said, yes, I am. I said, would you like me to call him? He said, I sure would. Tell him you. And I saw him not long ago, so we passed through Springfield, and I saw him. I said, tell him you talked to him. And I did. Lenny likes to tell about the time he played on the Capitol steps in Washington. L.M. Aylshire, 2424, mm-hmm. North Prospect.
Mm-hmm.
Prospect is about 2nd Street, 1st Street, 2nd East of National.
Yeah.
Off Kearney over there. You go out to Kearney.
Did you see him pretty alert when you talked to him?
Yeah, he was pretty alert. His wife said, answered the phone. She said, he'd be slow getting to the phone, but said, he'll talk to you. So I talked to him, and he...
Oh, good. And he played with all of you. I mean, he met Mitch here and all those guys.
Yeah.
He must have had a career. So he was there. Was that when he was just getting started, or?
Oh, I'd say in his mid-30s.
And he already lost his fingers by then?
Yeah. They said before he lost his fingers, he was a very good fiddler.
Mm-hmm.
The same way Willie Ballou. Willie Ballou lost that middle finger and played with these three.
Mm-hmm.
But he could do a good job with those three. And Lenny could play some simple tunes. He played for his crawdads.
Yeah.
He'd play simple tunes just with that one finger right here. But a lot of open strings, you know.
Yeah.
So I called him when I got home that night. That's Sunday night. We got home 2 o'clock or so, didn't we, Gordon, that day?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, I called him that night, and his wife said, he'll be slow getting the phone, but he'd like to talk to you. I said, you remember me, don't you? He said, wife. She said, oh, yes, I've been with those years before, lots of time. So he's there, and he played the piano, too. Of course, I didn't bother him. He sat on the piano, and he'd get an octave right there.
Uh-huh.
And then he just played
Right.
He played steel guitar back when they called it Hawaiian.
Yeah.
He and Homeboyman had an act. He played the steel and Home played the standard with him. They had a lot.
Did they play on the stage or did they go professional with it or just play around?
They played in the area, I'd say. But of course, Lenny played with the Weaver brothers.
Yeah. And he was with Grandpa.
Yeah.
And there's another guy I wanted to ask you about. Did you ever remember running this guy that used to play with him called Dale Parker?
I remember Dale Parker.
That's not his real name, but that's what he goes by.
Well, he played tenor banjo on a KWTO here for a long time. Slim Wilson group.
You got any more of your Uncle Tobe tunes you ever played for me? I'm trying to think. You see, Uncle Tobe never did, as far as you know, he never made up any songs or something.
Not that I know of. I never heard him talk of that. He had a lot of things like, he'd say, Ellie, what's the whistle that tune that Mark Galt used to play? that we liked so well. And she'd play it, Chief Whistler, and he'd play it. Mark Galt was an old timer. Here was a fiddler, and about off the old days, and they played together quite a lot. But he, and of course, this story I told you about him going to the dance, he played 27 dances since Thanksgiving.
Yeah, in February.
Yeah. Well, that's getting around, you know, to go
there that day and time. Yeah.
Yeah, and for a horseback ride and carrying a fiddle. Let's see.